were regularly written up after various meetings with council staff, CAFCAS employees, and so on. Neither Carissa nor Jim ever had an opportunity to see these notes, to check their veracity, or to comment on the judgments they contained. This process would not, of course, be permitted if they were facing criminal charges. The panel process equates to trying someone for an offence without giving them the chance to know what the case against them is based on. It is such a flagrant breach of natural justice that it would not be tolerated in any other legal process and should not be tolerated in adoption cases. Neither Carissa nor Jim stand accused of any offence whatever. The punishment they face, however, is one of the most terrible any parent can face, the forced removal of their own baby. And the awful truth is they would have more legal rights and would be treated in a more humane and just way if they were on trial for murdering their own child. It all meant that when Carissa and Jim eventually met the panel, they had no idea what points they should try to make because they did not know what they were accused of. Equally seriously, the allegations put before the panel by council staff, the accuracy of the allegations put before the panel by council staff is extremely questionable. One allegation, based on evidence from a council staff worker, was that Jim had actually been present at the time when Poppy was snatched from her mother's home. It was said that a man's voice making threatening comments was heard from another room in the flat where Carissa was living with Poppy. This was not only a fabrication, it must have been known to be a fabrication by council staff at the very time it was included among the items for consideration by the panel. While I'm not qualified to assess the suitability of my constituents to parent their own child, I am very concerned indeed about this case. In bringing it, Suffolk County Council have followed a procedure which ought to be outlawed in any civilised country. It is a process which denies parents the most basic human and legal rights. I'm also concerned about the apparent contortion that County Council Social Services and their appointed medical practitioners have gone through in order to justify their intervention and find grounds for adoption. It is clear that far more accountability and scrutiny is required for social workers, CAFCAS officials, expert witnesses and judges, and this is particularly the case when so many of the same people are frequently involved. For example, the judge who oversaw both a previous private law proceeding relating to Carissa's former husband also dealt with the case of Poppy. The CAFCAS practitioner, who is Poppy's guardian, was also involved in a custody dispute about Carissa's first child. Before concluding, I wish to mention briefly another constituency case involving this same CAFCAS worker. I consider the actions of this worker to be so damaging to the families she is appointed to help that as soon as I am legally permitted to do so, I shall name her publicly. In the meantime, I strongly advise CAFCAS that she should be suspended. In this other case, a previously stable relationship between Richard and his partner, who together had a young daughter, broke down in distressing circumstances when his partner's older daughter physically attacked Richard. Unable to return to the family home for which he had paid, and unwilling to bring charges against his stepdaughter, Richard moved out. At first, despite regular threats of violence against Richard and his family from the family of his former partner, threats which were so serious that significant protection measures had to be taken, Richard continued to enjoy almost daily access to his daughter. Daily access, that is, until this CAFCAS worker arrived on the scene. In flagrant contradiction of the merits of this case, and very much against the interests of the young girl concerned, the CAFCAS officer persuaded a court to cut Richard's access to his only daughter to a supervised session of no more than 3 hours a week. In the process, Richard's personal safety was seriously compromised. The result has been the destruction of the previously close and loving relationship between Richard and his daughter. Great distress has been caused to the whole of his family, and Richard's health and well-being have been gravely damaged. To sum up, I believe that the current procedure for resolving adoption cases where the natural parents wish to retain care and custody of their children is unfair, unjust, and should not be tolerated. The secrecy surrounding the process, together with the appalling lack of scrutiny and accountability in the social care and family court system, are made worse by the fact that members of Parliament are prevented from having proper information in relation to child protection cases. Like other honourable members, I am daily supporting constituents who have been let down by some branch of the state. Uniquely, in the area of child protection, I am expected to trust that public officials are doing everything absolutely correctly. I'm not allowed to make an informed judgment about this myself. Sadly, we know from the terrible Baby P case that sometimes social workers make grievous errors. How, therefore, can we believe that every time a child is forcibly removed from a loving home and from his or her natural parents, the judgment of the social workers is so perfect and faultless that it should not be open to any outside scrutiny? In the case of Poppy, it was only in September 2009, after a court had ruled that she should be permanently and forcibly adopted, that I was finally allowed access to the detailed case notes. Poppy's parents themselves are still struggling to see the data held on them, despite wanting to mount a private appeal. Once again, the rights of people accused of crimes, however serious, are far greater than those of parents of children whom social workers want to seize for adoption. In criminal cases, defendants have a right to receive copies of case conference notes and all evidence used against them in court. There are, of course, many cases where removing a child from the care of its parents is necessary and right. And tragically, decisions about whether or not to return an abused child to abusive parents may literally be a matter of life or death. The category, however, of emotional abuse is more complex. But in any circumstances, it is surely true that if the professionals involved were made more accountable, then decisions about permanent removal would be a little easier to justify. The problem of accountability is complex. But as an award-winning journalist, Camilla Cavendish, who studied the subject, points out, the privacy of the child has become synonymous with the privacy of the professionals. The other lesson from the case of Poppy is that the emphasis must shift away from removing young children from parents who may themselves be vulnerable and somewhat inadequate, and on to providing support for those same parents. If a fraction of the effort, cost and time that was spent by Suffolk County Council staff on trying to justify the removal of Poppy from her parents had instead been devoted to helping Carissa and Jim, then they would have strengthened a family instead of destroying it. Social workers should provide more supportive parenting help early on. The judge suggested that Jim would require 6 months to a year of therapy in September 2009, which did not fit into Poppy's timescales. But this family was known to social services prior to her birth, giving them as much as 18 months to work with this couple had they so desired. Tens of thousands of pounds have been spent on the court process for this case, money that could have been used to help this family and others in their position. I urge the Minister to institute an immediate inquiry into how the adoption process works in the cases of very young babies born to parents who wish to keep them. 16 years ago, I was a minister myself at the Department of Health, where I had responsibility for adoption and social services policy. I believe that this is a subject of critical importance to many families which transcends normal party political boundaries. Let the case of Poppy be the catalyst which leads to a change in these unfair procedures.